are going to set the tone with a song. Lisa, Betty, Summertime.
So hopefully all of you know this very, very famous piece called Summertime. Do sing along if you feel like it.
It's from Pauline List.
Yeah, it's, I mean, it was sung in one of the musicals Maya Angelou acted in called Porgy and Bess. And it just is very, it fits the sort of different times that we will be reading about.
In 1969. It was the first of her 7 volumes of autobiography, published by Virago Press. The 7th and final volume, Mom and Me, was published in 2013. She wrote 3 collections of essays, many volumes of poetry, including His Day Is Done, a tribute to Nelson Mandela. She worked in Cairo and Accra, Ghana, for several years, editing a journal and writing articles. She was known for her fabulous parties. And she wrote 2 cookbooks. Everything she wrote was edited by the famous Virago Press Random House editor, Martin Lewis. She had a lifetime appointment as Reynolds Professor of American Studies at Wake Forest University of North Carolina. Maya Angelou died on the 28th of May, 2014. Maya Angelou was born Marguerite Annie Johnson in St. Louis, Missouri, on April 4, 1928, the second child of Bailey Johnson, a doorman and Navy dietitian, and Vivian Baxter Johnson, a nurse and card dealer. Strange occupations. Angelo's older brother, Bailey Jr., nicknamed Marguerite, Maya, derived from my, or Maya, sister. So it has nothing to do with our Maya. We are happy and honored tonight to have as our special guest American Ambassador to Bangladesh, Marcia Berninger. But more importantly for tonight than being an ambassador, old friend and fellow Maya Angelou enthusiast. Marcia will primarily read the great poem On the Pulse of Morning, which Maya recited for Bill Clinton's inaugural as President of America. Maya Angelou's autobiography, starting with I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, which our favorite actor, Sunil Tandon, will shortly read an excerpt from, are chronicles of Black American life that explode around us with life and warmth. A life lived after slavery ended, but with racial discrimination still alive and kicking, along with the Ku Klux Klan, lynchings, though outlawed even in the southern states like Arkansas, where we begin this evening's great journey, penned by this phenomenal woman, Sunil.
Excerpt from I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, the first volume of autobiography written by Maya Angelou. When I was 3 and my brother Bailey 4, we arrived in the musty little town of Stamps, Arkansas, wearing tags on our wrists, which instructed, to whom it may concern, that we were Marguerite and Bailey Johnson Jr. from Long Beach, California, en route to Stamps, Arkansas, care of Mrs. Annie Henderson. Our parents had decided to put an end to their calamitous marriage, and father shipped us home to his mother. Years later, I discovered that the United States had been crossed thousands of times by frightened black children traveling alone to their newly affluent parents in northern cities or back to grandmothers in southern towns. We lived with our grandmother, Mrs. Annie Henderson, and her son from a second marriage, Uncle Willie, in the rear of the store which she had owned for some 25 years. The formal name of the store was the William Johnson General Merchandise Store. She had the store built in the heart of the Negro area of Stamps. Over the years, it had become the lay center of activities in the black part of the town. Customers could find food staples, a good variety of colored thread, mash for hogs, corn for chickens, coal oil for lamps, light bulbs for the wealthy, shoestrings, hairdressing, balloons, and flower seeds. Anything not visible had only to be ordered. Each year I watched the field across from the store turn caterpillar green, then gradually frosting white. I knew exactly how long it would be before the big wagons would pull up into the front of the yard and load on the cotton pickers at daybreak to carry them to the remnants of slavery's plantations. During the picking season, my grandmother would get out of bed at 4 o'clock. She never used an alarm clock. And crack down on her knees and chant in a sleep-filled voice, "Our Father, thank you for letting me see this new day. Thank you that you didn't allow the bed I lay on last night to be my cooling board, nor my blanket my winding sheet. Guide my feet this day along the straight and narrow, and help me put a bridle on my tongue. Bless this house and everyone in it. Thank you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen." The lamplight in the store gave a soft, make-believe feeling to our world, which made me want to whisper and walk about on tiptoe. When the wooden slat was removed from the door, the early morning air forced its way in with the bodies of people who had walked miles to reach the pickup place. "Sister, I'll have 2 cans of sardines." "I'm gonna work so fast today, I'm gonna make you look like you're standing still. Let me have a hunk of cheese and some silly crackers. Just give me a couple of them fat peanut patties." That would be from a picker who was taking his lunch. The greasy brown paper sack was stuck behind the bib of his overalls. He'd use the candy as a snack before the noon sun called the workers to rest. In those tender mornings, the store was full of laughing, joking, boasting, and practicing. The champion picker of the previous day was the hero of the door. The sound of the full cotton sacks dragging over the floor, the murmurs of waking people were sliced by the cash register as we rang up the 5 cent 6. Late afternoon had all the features of normal Arkansas. The dying sunlight, people were careless about their empty cotton sacks. Brought back to the store, the pickers would step out the backs of trucks and fall down the road, dirt disappointed, to the ground. No matter how much they had baked, it wasn't enough. Their wages wouldn't even get them out of debt to my grandmother, not to mention the staggering bill that waited on them at the white commissary downstairs. This afternoon morning had been replaced with grumbles about cheating houses, weighted scales, snakes, skimpy cotton, and dusty roads. Later years, I was to confront the stereotype picture of gay, song-singing cotton pickers with such inordinate rage that I was told, even by fellow blacks, that my paranoia was embarrassing. But I had seen the fingers cut by the mean little cotton balls, and I had witnessed the blacks and shoulders and arms and legs resisting any further demands. Some of the workers would leave their work sacks at the store to be picked up the following morning, but a few had to take the toll for repairs. I winced to picture them sewing the coarse material under a corn oil lamp with fingers stiffening from the day's work. In too few hours, they would have to walk back to Sister Henderson's store to get victuals and load again onto the trucks. Then they would face another day of trying to earn enough for a whole year with the heavy knowledge they were going to end the season as they had started it without the money or credit necessary to sustain a family for 3 months. In cotton picking time, the late afternoons revealed the harshness of black southern life, which in the early morning had been softened by nature's blessing of grogginess, forgetfulness, and the soft landlord.
And a poem. My Arkansas, there is a deep brooding in Arkansas. Old crimes like moss bend from poplar trees. The southern earth is much too red for comfort. Sunrise seems to hesitate and in that second lose its incandescent aim, and dusk no more shadows. The past is brighter yet. Old hates, anti-venom lace, are writ but not discarded. Today is yet to come in Arkansas. It rides in awful waves of brooding. From the book I know why the cage bird sings, I'm now going to read to you the painful story of Maya's rape. As an 8-year-old child, by her mother's love, after an excruciating court case for the child, whose rapist was let out of jail in a day. He was then discovered murdered, kicked to death 4 days later. On a late spring Saturday in St. Louis, where we children were living with our mother, Vivian Baxter, Mr. Freeman, my mother's lover, a foreman in the Southern Pacific Railway Yards, raped me. I was 8. I sometimes had nightmares, and on my particularly bad nights, my mother would take her into her bed to sleep with her in the large bed with Mr. Freeman. One morning, she got out of bed early for an early errand, and I fell asleep again. But I woke to a pressure, a strange feeling on my left leg. It was too soft to be a hand, and it wasn't the touch of clothes. I turned my head a little to the left to see if Mr. Freeman was awake and gone. But his eyes were open and both hands were above the cover. I knew, as if I had always known, it was his thing on my leg. He said, just stay right there, Ricky. I ain't gonna hurt you. Mr. Freeman pulled me to him and put his hands between my legs. He didn't hurt, but Mama had drilled into my head, keep your legs closed and they let anybody see your pocketbook. Don't get scared, Mr. Freeman said. He took my hand and said, feel it. It was warm and squiggly, like the inside of a freshly killed chicken. Then he dragged me on top of his chest with his left arm, and his right hand was moving so fast, and his heart was beating so hard, I was afraid he would die. Finally, he was quiet. And then came the nice part. He held me so softly that I wished he would never let me go. I felt at home. Kitty, do you love Bailey?
Yes.
If you ever tell anyone what we did, I'll have to kill Bailey. Thought that he might kill Bailey. Stunned me. Finally, on a late spring Saturday, when no one else was at home, he really raped me. He was sitting in the big chair by the radio. His pants were open and his thing was standing out of his breeches by itself. He turned on the radio and said, "Now this ain't gonna hurt you much. You liked it before, didn't you?" His legs were squeezing my waist. "Pull down your drawers." I was sure any minute my mother or Bailey would bust in and save me. We were just playing before. He snatched down my bloomers and dragged me closer to him. Turning up the radio loud, too loud, he said, "If you scream, I'm gonna kill you. And if you tell, I'm gonna kill Bailey." Then there was the pain. The breaking and entering when even the senses are torn apart. The act of rape on the natural body is a matter of the needle giving because the camel can't. The child gives because the body can, and the mind of the violator cannot. I thought I had died. I woke up in a whitewashed world and it had to be heaven. But Mr. Freeman was there and he was washing me. "I didn't mean to hurt you, Liddy. I didn't mean it. Remember, don't tell a soul." "No, sir, Mr. Freeman, I won't tell. It's just that I'm so tired. I'm just going to lay down a while, please." "No, you better go to the library. Your mama ought to be coming home soon. You just act natural." Walking down the street, I felt the wet on my pants and my hips seemed to be coming out of their sockets. I couldn't sit on the hard seat in the library. So I walked by the empty lot where Bailey was playing ball. But he wasn't there. Then I headed home. I went straight to bed after hiding my red and yellow stained drawers under the mattress. Later, everyone came back. Mother was convinced I was coming down with measles. Mr. Freeman came in and leaned over, his own face a threat that could have smothered me. Very quietly, "If you tell, if you tell." I slept through till the next morning, and Mother asked, "How are you feeling, baby?" "Where's Bailey?" I asked. "Asleep," she said. I asked her where Mr. Freeman was. He's gone, moved this morning. I'm going to take your temperature now. Mother said I should be bathed. And the linen changed since I had sweated so much. She picked me up. And Bailey began to change the bed. And the panties I had hidden under the mattress fell at Mother's feet. In the hospital, Bailey told me that I had to tell who did that to me or the man would hurt another little girl. When I said the man would kill him, Bailey said knowingly, he can't kill me. I won't let him. So I told him. Bailey cried at the side of my bed until I cried. Almost 15 years passed before I saw my brother. Mr. Freeman was arrested. In the trial, I was asked if he'd ever done anything like it before. And I couldn't say yes. I couldn't tell him how he loved me one day for a few minutes and how he had held me close. I swore on the Bible that he had not. Mr. Freeman was sentenced to 1 year and a day, but he never got a chance to do his time. He was found dead on the lot in the slaughterhouse a few days later. No one knew who had done it. A man was dead because I had lied on the Bible. Would Christ turn his back on me? Evil would rush off my tongue if I tried to open my mouth. I had to stop talking. When I refused to be the child they knew and accepted me to be, I was called impudent, and my muteness, sullenness. For a while, I was punished for being so uppity. And then we were on the train going back to Stapps. Maya said years later, I thought my voice had killed him. I killed that man because I told his name. Lisa's going to sing Caged Bird. Thank you. to Mama and the storms in Arkansas. Because no one could handle a nearly mute child. She was brought back to beautiful life by Mrs. Bertha Flowers. And I'm going to ask Marcia to please read this piece from her autobiography.
Mrs. Bertha Flowers was the aristocrat of black stamps. She had the grace control to appear warm in the coldest weather, and on the Arkansas summer days, it seemed she had a private breeze cooling her. She was one of the few gentlewomen I have ever known, and was and has remained throughout my life the measure of what a human can be. Visiting the store one day, she asked Mama's permission to take Marguerite home. I hear you are doing very good schoolwork, Marguerite, but that it is all written. The teachers report that they have trouble getting you to talk in class. Now, no one is going to make you talk. Possibly no one can. But bear in mind, language is man's way of communicating with his fellow man, and it is language alone which separates him from the lower animals. That was a totally new idea to me. She continued, your grandmother says you read a lot. That's good, but not good enough. Words mean more than what is set down on paper. It takes the human voice to infuse them with the shades of deeper meaning. She said she was going to give me some books that I must not only read them, I must read them aloud. When I went to take the books back, the odors of her house surprised me. Somehow, I had never connected Mrs. Flowers with food, or eating, or any other common experiences of common people. I made tea cookies this morning. You see, I had planned to invite you for cookies and lemonade, so we could have a little chat. I wanted to gobble up the room entire and take it to Bailey, who would help me analyze it and enjoy it. As I ate, she began the first of what we later called my lessons in living. She said I must always be intolerant of ignorance, but understanding of illiteracy. That some people unable to go to school were more educated and even more intelligent than college professors. When I finished the cookies, she brushed off the table and brought a thick, small book from the bookcase. I had read A Tale of Two Cities, but when she started reading, I heard poetry for the first time in my life. It was the best of times and the worst of times. Her voice slid in and curved down through and over the words. She was nearly singing. I wanted to look at the pages. Were they the same I had read? How do you like that? She said. I had to speak. I said, yes, ma'am. There is one more thing. Take this book of poems and memorize one for me. Next time you pay me a visit, I want you to recite. On that first day, I ran down the hill and into the road. I was light, and what a difference it made. I was respected, not as Mrs. Henderson's grandchild or Bailey's sister, but just for being Marguerite Johnson. Assertive pride in our history and culture, but also in the texture of our hair, and especially a love for the rainbow of colors in which we come. All wrapped up in the word and the idea, black. We took back the word black, stripping it of its negative connotations, in part thanks to the powerful and beautiful portrayals that Maya Angelou gave us. If you were a teen in 1969, like I was, The Caged Bird Sings was required reading. Ain't That Bad, Dancing the Funky Chicken, Eating Ribs and Tips, Digging All the Latest Sounds, and Drinking Gin and Sips. Putting down that do-rag, tighten up my fro, wrapping up in blackness, don't I shine and glow? Hearing Stevie Wonder, cooking beans and rice, going to the opera, checking out Leontine Price. Get down, Jesse Jackson. Dance on, Alvin Ailey. Talk, Miss Barbara Jordan. Groove, Miss Pearly Bailey. Now, ain't they bad? And ain't they black? And ain't they black? And ain't they bad? And ain't they bad? And ain't they black? And ain't they fine? Black like the hour of the night, when your love turns and wriggles close to your side. Black as the earth, which has given birth to nations, and when all else is gone, will abide. Bad as the storm that leaps raging from the heavens, bringing the welcome rain. Bad as the sun burning orange hot at midday, lifting the waters again. Arthur Ashe on the tennis court, Muhammad Ali in the ring, Andre Watts and Andrew Young, black men doing their thing, dressing in purples and pinks and greens, exotic as rum and coats, living our lives with flash and style. Ain't we colorful folks? Now ain't we bad? And ain't we black? And ain't we black? And ain't we bad? And ain't we bad? And ain't we black? And ain't we fine?
Musician. They married despite the condemnation of interracial relationships at the time and the disapproval of Maya's mother. After their divorce, Angelou formed her own nom de plume by combining her nickname Maya with a version of her ex-husband's last name. To earn money during high school, 15-year-old Maya worked as a conductor on San Francisco's now iconic streetcar system, then called the Market Street Railway Company. Maya once said they refused to give her a job because of the color of her skin. But her mother encouraged her to persevere. And after 2 weeks of returning to the office every day, she finally got the job. "I love the uniforms," she said.
Brother Moe, he began to shout, "Run, Joe, pay the man's
gave birth to a son, Clyde Guy Johnson. She writes that she became pregnant after having sex with a boy to prove she wasn't a lesbian. Guy Johnson was her only child, but he gave her a grandchild, whom she loved and fought for when Guy's divorced white wife ran away with him. From the mid-50s, Maya was a professional singer, dancer, and actor. She started her singing career at a San Francisco nightclub called the Purple Onion, when she sang and danced to calypso music. Calypso had recently become a rage in the US. Up to that point, she went by the name of Marguerite Johnson, or Rita, but now she changed her professional name to Maya Angelou, a combination of her nickname and former married surname. A distinctive name that set her apart and captured the feel of her calypso dance performances. Later, she toured Europe in a production of the opera Porgy and Bess, where she played the role of Clara. She performed in Jean Genet's play, The Blacks, along with James Earl Jones, Louis Gossett, and Cicely Tyson. Sorry. And she recorded her first album, Miss Calypso, which is where this song is from, called Run Joe, and appeared in a Calypso-themed off-Broadway that inspired the 1957 film, Calypso Heatwave, in which she sang and performed her own compositions. And we will end this little bit with another one of her very fun calypso songs called Stone Cold Dead in the Market.
Favorite actors, Kanika Arora, or Kalina, if you like to say, brings out a lesser known facet of Maya Angelou.
Jem, much has been written and said about Maya's poetry, plays and memoirs, but very little about her skills as an accomplished cook, a cookbook writer and a home entertainer. She had a deep love and understanding of food, and how passionately she enjoyed sharing it. Her cooking was a virtuoso presentation that was part monologue, part dance routine, totally engaging and absolutely fascinating. It was a whole new form of dinner theatre. Well, in 2004, she wrote her first cookbook called Hallelujah, The Welcome Table, A Lifetime of Memories with Recipes. She excelled at traditional African-American foods and slow-cooked country dishes of the year. And she delighted in the fact that they represented tradition, history, and connectedness. Cooking is a natural extension to my autobiography. Writing and cookery are two different means of communication. Eating is so intimate. It's very sensual. When you invite someone to your table and you want to cook, you're inviting the person. Do you know what? Said Maya. For a second cookbook, Great Food All Day Long, she put together a collection of savory meals that will ask you to eat at 8:30 a.m. as they were at 8:30 a.m. Well, let's see. Let's talk about her cold potato salad, and let's see if it's good enough to eat at 7:40 p.m. Indian Standard Time. Now, quickly, let me just take you through the ingredients. We need about 6 cups of cooked potatoes, peeled and diced. We need a medium red onion that I think we have here, a cup of celery, finely diced, a cup of dill pickles, chopped, or a dill relish, a cup of sweet relish, 8 large boiled eggs, or 4 if you're not too keen, some salt and freshly ground pepper, and a cup of mint, and fresh parsley, chopped garnish. And then what you do is you just master chef your way through it, or my way through it. So I'm just going to put it all in. Oops. There go the potatoes.
Your apron.
Oh dear. We can't do it without the apron. My mother will be mortified. Thank you, Bruno. Ah, it's a pretty apron, so, you know, let's do it justice.
Right, there you go.
My apron. Right. And starting at the top again. We'll go back to the potatoes. The potatoes. We'll put the onions in, some celery, oops, right, we've got some relish, not too much, but just enough to sort of give it the right flavour, infuse it with the right amount of flavour, depending on the number of people you're actually making this for, and the number of potatoes you've used. I think they're all right there. You could do it with gherkins as well. If you don't have pickles, you can manage it. Right. And all we have to do now is, oh, that's later. Just put lots and lots of mint. Simple. So worth it. Ooh. Yes. Mix it all up. Yes. Parsley. Or coriander in India if you don't manage to get parsley. Can't go wrong with that. And you just put your boiled eggs as garnish as well on the top of it. Or skip it if you're vegetarian. You've been right. Okay. I think we've done here. Just a little bit more of this parsley. White colour, we are going to have ourselves some lovely Maya's cold potato salad. I hope it's going to be served outside in the Ashura Theatre.
Yes, you know, this is a wonderful surprise. What you see and hear, you're going to find in the cafe at the end of the show.
The butter, the salt and pepper, we'll be all right without that. But I have another surprise for you, and a little birdie tells me that we are going to have another one of Maya's goodies served at the Akshara Theatre. Am I right in presuming?
You are absolutely right.
Right, in that case, I shall just quickly share the recipe with you. Change the mood a bit. For the popovers, yes, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have popovers. I've got one here just to entice you. Just to tease you a little bit. I've been instructed not to eat it by now. A little later. Okay, for that you need 2 eggs, a cup of milk, 2 tablespoons of butter, melted. Well, in India you don't have to work hard on that bit. A cup of sifted all-purpose flour, and just a pinch, a quarter of a teaspoon of salt. And you preheat the oven to 425 degrees, and you grease 6 custard cups, or iron pop over the pan. You beat the eggs slightly in a large bowl. Add the milk and butter, add the flour, beat it vigorously for just 2 minutes. You pour the batter into very hot custard cups, and you fill it about 2/3. And you bake it for 40 minutes. Then Bob's your uncle, and you serve it at once. As Maya said, the best comfort food will always be greens, cornbread, and fried chicken. Can't argue with that. But remember, people will judge you by your actions and not your intentions. You may have a heart of gold,
hard-boiled egg.
Thank you.
Come on. Can't wait to taste all that. I'm not touching right now. Maya actually spent some time of her life in Africa as well. In the early 60s, those were the years of Maya's activism. After meeting Martin Luther King Jr., she and author John Oliver Kibbons organized the legendary Cabaret for Freedom. Around the same time, she met and lived for several years with South African freedom fighter Busunzi Maki, though they were never officially married. She and her son Guy moved with Maki to Cairo, where she edited the English language weekly newspaper, The Arab Observer. And after she and Maki separated, Maya and her son Guy lived for several years in Accra, Ghana, along with other African-American intellectuals as part of the Pan-Africanist movement. She worked at the University of Ghana, edited and wrote for the African Review, the Ghanaian Times, and Radio Ghana, and also worked and performed for Ghana's National Theatre. Now, she became close friends with Malcolm X during his visit to Accra in the early 1960s. In the mid-1960s, Maya returned to the US to help Malcolm X build a new civil rights organization, the Organization of Afro-American Unity. But, as we know, he was assassinated shortly afterwards. Devastated after the assassination of Malcolm X, and again a little later by the assassination of Martin Luther King, Maya drifted back to New York's writing scene with support and encouragement from her writer friends. In 1968, she met Virago Press editor Robert Loomis and wrote her first autobiography, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings, from which I read earlier in this evening. Now, I think Chalabala is going to recite perhaps one of the most famous and popular poems, really well known poem.
And the poem is Still I Rise. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still, like dust, I'll rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you beset with gloom? Could I walk that I've got oil wells humping in my living room? Just like moons and like suns, with the certainty of tides, just like hope springing high, still I rise. Do you want to see me broken? Bowed head and lowered eyes? Should shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened by my soulful cries. Does my importance offend you? Don't you take it awful hard? Could I laugh like I've got gold mines digging in my own backyard? You may shoot me with your words. You may cut me with your eyes. You may kill me with your hateful death. But still, like air, I'll rise. Does my sexiness upset you? Does it come as a surprise that I dance like I've got diamonds at the meeting of my thighs? Out of the huts of industry, shame, I rise. Up from the past that's rooted in pain, I rise. I'm a black ocean, leaping and wide, welling and swelling. I bear in the tide, leaving behind nights of terror and fear. I rise into a daybreak that's wondrously clear. I rise. Gifts my ancestors gave. I am the dream and the hope of the slave. I rise, I rise, I rise.
In the 70s, Maya worked on the West Coast as a music composer. Yes, there's no end to her talent. She wrote and composed for singer Roberta Flack and composed several movie scores as well. She wrote articles, short stories, TV scripts, documentaries, autobiographies, and poetry, produced plays, and was named visiting professor at several colleges and universities. She was even nominated for a Tony Award in 1973 for her role in the play Look Away. In the late 1970s, Maya met Oprah Winfrey and became Winfrey's lifetime friend and mentor. In the early 80s, after her second marriage to Welshman Paul Dufour ended, Maya returned to the southern United States because she felt she had to come to terms with her past. And despite having no bachelor's degree, accepted the lifetime Reynolds Professorship of American Studies at Wake Forest University in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. From that point on, she considered herself a teacher who writes. She taught a variety of subjects that reflected her interests, including philosophy, ethics, theology, science, theater, and writing. She continued to write her seven-part biography through the decades. She supported Senator Hillary Clinton's campaign for presidency in 2008. When Clinton's campaign ended, she put her support behind Senator Barack Obama. And when he became the first African-American president of the United States, Maya stated, "We are growing up beyond the idiocies of racism and sexism." Maya Angelou received no less than 3 Grammy Awards for 3 of her spoken word albums, the first of which was for the poem she wrote for President Bill Clinton's inauguration in 1993, "By the Pulse of Morning." And I think we should ask Marsha to read that one.
Seek no haven in my shadow. I will give you no hiding place down here. The rock cries out today, and you may stand on me, but do not hide your face across the wall of the world. A river sings a beautiful song. Come rest here by my side. The river sings and sings on. There is a true yearning to respond to. The singing river and the wise rock. So say the Asian, the Hispanic, the Jew, the African and Native American, the Sioux, the Catholic, the Muslim, the French, the Greek, the Irish, the rabbi, the priest, the sheep, the gay, the straight, the preacher, the privileged, the homeless, the teacher. They hear, they all hear, the speaking of the tree. Today, the first and last of every tree speaks to humankind. Come to me, here beside the river. Plant yourself beside me, here beside the river. Each of you, descendant of some passed on, traveler who has paid for. I, the rock, I, the river, I, the tree, I am yours. Your passages have been paid. Lift up your faces. You have a piercing need. For this bright morning dawning for you, history, despite its wrenching pains, cannot be unlived. And if faced with courage, need not be lived again. The rock, the river, the tree, your country. No less to Midas than the mendicant. Here on the pulse of this new day, you may have the grace to look up and out and into your sister's eyes, into your brother's face, your country, and say simply, very simply, with hope, good morning.
Worker in her 1974 memoir, Gathered Together in My Name. The faces, bodies, and smells of the drinks made an unending paisley pattern in her mind. Given the idea of music as salvation in Gathered Together, it seems that the character Troubadour Martin behaves like a soothing musician in keeping Maya away from the turmoil of drug addiction. She admits that Troubadour Martin is not his real name, but that the following episode that I'm going to read is true. In Oakland, my fantasy settled upon becoming Mrs. Troubadour Martin, who is kind, generous, and quiet. And although we made a desultory kind of love a few times, he never asked for more. The ideal husband. But I nagged him to reveal his real life. Finally, he agreed and took me to a seedy hotel in the slums near the wharf. Taking a key, he led me upstairs. My first impression was that I was in a city bus station very early in the morning. People sat and lounged on every available place. Three bodies were draped over a bed. Men and women sat on the floor, backed by the wall. Two women sat in one chair, and all, black and white, were dozing off or waking up or fast asleep. No one noticed our entrance. Troubadour reached back for me in the dim lamplight. Come on. I reeled and tried to shake my sluggish brain awake, but it couldn't go
compute the situation. It seemed a slow whole minute before the scene registered. This was a hit joint for addicts. Fear flushed my face and neck and made the room tremble before me. I had been prepared to experiment with drugs, but I hadn't counted on this ugly exposure. As I watched the wretched nod and scratch, I felt my own innocence as real as a grain of sand between my teeth. I was pure as moonlight and had only begun to live. My escapades were the fumblings of youth and to be forgiven as such. I twisted for the door behind me and tried to snatch my hand away, but Drew held on. "Come on, I want you to see something." I was afraid to scream and alarm the addicts and then dream it. If I pulled free and reached the lobby, would the desk clerk know that I wasn't going to the police and allow me to go? Drew tugged at me, and we stumbled over outstretched legs toward an open bathroom door. In the bathroom, Troubadour removed his jacket and gave it to me. He rolled up his shirt sleeve. Time for Troubadour and me moved as if we were swimming underwater. He took a tablespoon from the sink and a small square of paper from his pocket. The senses of sound, taste, and touch had disappeared, but I had never seen so clearly or smelled so acutely. The powder was dusted into the spoon and he dribbled a little water over it. He held three matches under the belly of the spoon while the mixture simmered. The sweet smell went into my nose and unlocked my tongue. "Don't do it, Drew. Please, don't." "Shut up and watch." He tied his arm about the elbow with his tie and tightened it with his teeth. Then he took a syringe from the grimy face bowl and filled it with the hot, clear liquid. High standing keloid scars ran down his inner arm, and the black flesh was purple and yellow in a face with fresh sores. He pushed the needle into a scar and wiggled it around, then took it out and tried another. "Please, Drew, shut up and watch this." The needle pricked one of the soft scabs, and rich yellow pus flowed out and down to his arm to the waist. My tears, which had been terror frozen, thawed at the sight of the man who had been so nice to me, jabbing and pricking in his own flesh, oblivious to the pain and ugliness. The needle found its place, and blood, mixed with a few drops of heroin, had sneaked across his upheld arm. He loosened the tie with his teeth, and as if I had X-ray vision, I watched the narcotic reach his brain. His face muscles slackened, and he leaned heavily against the wall. "Now, you want some?" Slow lips, slow question. "No." "You sure?" "I can cook up for you." His head lolled, but he kept his eyes on me. "I'm sure. I don't want it." "Then I want you to promise me you won't use shit. That's why they call it shit. It is. You're a nice lady, Rita. I don't want to see you change. Promise me you'll stay like I found you. Nice. I promise. Now let me rest a little in the car, then I'll take you home." He slumped behind the steering wheel for a half hour, and I watched him. I thought about the kindness of the man. I wanted him before the security I thought he'd give me. I loved him as he slouched, nodding, his mouth open and the saliva sliding down his chin as slowly as the blood had flowed down his arm. No one had ever cared for me so much. He had exposed himself to me to teach me a lesson. And I learned it as I sat in the dark car, inhaling the odors of the wharf. The life of the underworld was truly a rat race, and most of its inhabitants scurried like rodents in the sewers and gutters of the world. I had walked the precipice and seen it all. And at the critical moment, one man's generosity pushed me safely away from the edge. He
finally awake, and then we headed back to Oakland. In front of my house, I told him that he should take his clothes. I explained that I planned to move back to the city. He said, sell them. You need the money. You've got a baby. There's plenty more stores and plenty more clothes. So the next day, I took the clothes, my bags and guy back to mother's. I had no idea what I was going to make of my life, but I had given a promise and found my innocence. I swore I'd never lose it again.
Maya Angelou died on May 28, 2014 in her home in North Carolina. Though she was in poor health, she was working on another book. And during her memorial service at Wake Forest University, her son Guy Johnson stated that despite being in constant pain, she wrote 4 books during the last 10 years of her life. He said, she left this mortal plane with no loss of accuracy and no loss in comprehension. And Marsha, would you need these last words, please?
This is what Michelle Obama said at Maya Angelou's memorial. Maya Angelou's words were so powerful that they carried a little black girl from the south side of Chicago all the way to the White House. She touched me. She touched all of you. She touched people all across the globe, including a young white woman from Kansas who named her daughter after Maya and raised her son to be the first black president of the United States. In so many ways, Maya Angelou knew us. She knew our hope, our pain, our ambition, our fear, our anger, our shame, and she assured us that in spite of it all, in fact, because of it all, we were good. She didn't just want to be phenomenal herself. She wanted all of us to be phenomenal right alongside her. And in doing so, she paved the way for me and Oprah and so many others just to be our good old black woman selves.
And now, I read Phenomenal Woman. Pretty people wonder where my secret lies. I'm not cute or built to suit a fashion model size. But when I start to tell them, they think I'm telling lies. I say, it's in the reach of my arms, the span of my hips, the stride of my step, the curl of my lips. I'm a woman, phenomenally, phenomenal woman. That's me. I walk into a room just as cool as you please. And to a man, the fellows stand or fall down on their knees. Then they swarm around me, a hive of honeybees. I say, it's the fire in my eyes and the flash of my teeth, the swing in my waist and the joy in my feet. I'm a woman, phenomenally, phenomenal woman, that's me. Men themselves have wondered what they see in me. They try so much, but they can't touch my inner mystery. When I try to show them, they say, they still can't see. I say, it's in the arch of my back. The sun of my smile, the ride of my breath, the grace of my style. I'm a woman, phenomenally, phenomenal woman, that's me. sure you understand just why my head's not bowed. I don't shout or jump about or have to talk real loud. When you see me passing, want to make you proud, I say, it's in the click of my heels, the bend of my hair, the palm of my hand, the need for my care. Because I'm a woman, phenomenally, phenomenal woman, that's me. And now, don't forget the treat that's waiting for you in the cafe. Outside in a moment. Please, will you lead the way?